Oh, he's traveling to Europe today. I have to be there with him. Oh, he's traveling to the US today. I have to be there with him. There shouldn't be any room for competition. The Bible says we are helpmates. You are to support him. You are to compliment him. You are to cooperate with him. Thank you, Jesus. You have a lot of role to play. You have a lot of role to play as a pastor's wife. And the first thing I'm going to mention here, number one, I said minister to the Lord. Minister to the Lord. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 17. I don't know if they can bring it up on the screen so that we'll just see something. I want to point out something to you. Okay. It says, and the Lord plagued Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. I believe this is the story that every one of us here, we are already familiar with. When Abraham entered Egypt, the Bible said there was famine and he entered Egypt. Of course, that was the first mistake he made. Because the Bible says, woe unto them that go down to Egypt. That was the first mistake. When he got there, he lied. He said, Sarah is my sister, not my wife. And they brought her to the king. They brought her to Pharaoh. Now listen. Let me advise us. As you're a pastor's wife here, listen to me. Your husband is making a mistake. That doesn't mean you have to join him to make that same mistake. Your duty is to correct him and pray for him. Are you listening to me? They brought her to Pharaoh and she had everything at her disposal. She had everything. At least I would have made her say, of course, is he not my husband? As I should introduce myself as a sister. Let me just sit back and enjoy. But she didn't do that. She knew she was a covenant child. You must understand your place as a pastor's wife. You must understand your place. Your duty is to see that things are put right. The Bible says Pharaoh had no peace. And he called on Abraham and said, you want to put me in trouble? Why didn't you tell me that this woman is your wife? Please, carry your load, carry your trouble and leave this place. Go! Leave this place. Because the woman decided to maintain her stand. When you see anything going wrong in the ministry and you know this thing is not right, you don't need to compromise. You need to stand, maintain your stand and help your husband so that that thing can be corrected. You remember Ananias and Sapphira? Of course, you know if Sapphira had talked to the husband wisely, I'm sure the man would have listened to her. But she decided to go in the way of the husband to make the same mistake. And what happened to both of them? But in your own case, I speak to you today as a pastor's wife. God is putting upon you, resting upon your life, the wisdom to make the difference. I said the wisdom to make the difference. In the name of Jesus. I said it's your relationship with God that will fight for you. Your relationship with God is your relationship with God that will fight for you. That was why Pharaoh became restless. Trouble came upon his house because he released that woman. She's somebody else's wife. Because of her relationship with the Lord, She refused to compromise. She refused to take to the wrong counsel or the wrong advice that was coming from the husband. And I'm sure she was able to correct it. That was why Pharaoh said, please come. You'd have told me this woman is your wife. Please carry your wife and go your way. Hallelujah. I know the Lord is blessing somebody. Sarah also had an angelic visitation because of her closeness, the proximity, her closeness with the Lord. A woman that fears the Lord. She had an angelic visitation also. And if you are here as a pastor's wife, it is possible for you to just keep having an encounter with the Lord if only you will maintain your relationship with the Lord. And I know that grace is coming upon you today in the name of Jesus. Number two, I said minister to your husband. Minister to your husband. And the first thing I said, believe in him. Do you know from the place where we read, Zechariah, the Bible says, went into the temple and came back dumb. Came back dumb. In these days that many pastors' wives feel they know everything, I am sure that is the day they will pack their things and leave the house. This man, I'm even suspecting you. You left the house without any problem. You came back dumb. How? She was still submissive to the husband. She was submissive to the husband. And it was the because of her heart, God decides to bless her. She conceived. She took him. Listen, do you know that when Zechariah came back after the encounter he had, when he came, as a matter of fact, before the angel of the Lord met with him, Elizabeth was not pregnant. Now tell me, if Elizabeth didn't allow the husband touch her, and maybe feel irritated, I don't know what is going on, I don't understand you anymore. Like some women will complain, my husband is this, my husband is that, why is this one going on, why is that one going on? And instead of you to put hands together to provide solution to the problem, you start avoiding your husband. If Elizabeth had done that, she would not have conceived. The Bible says she was still submissive to the husband. And that was why it happened. She took him. She was conceived of John the Baptist. I know that after this meeting today, God will do something different in your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Woman, be submissive to your husband. Be submissive. No matter what you feel you are not comfortable with in the ministry, you still need to be submissive. All you need to is to go to God in prayer and have it corrected. Hallelujah. Number two, I said pray for him. Pray for him. Number one, believe in him. Number two, pray for him. In Job chapter 2 verse 9, the Bible made us to understand that when the affliction came upon Job, his properties, the children, his health was affected. What happened? The woman came up to tell him, he said, do you still hold fast your integrity? Do you still hold fast your integrity? But listen to me, child of God. Do you know that God has a reason for sparing the wife of Job? Have you ever imagined it? That the news came, the children, they've all gone, the cattle, the properties, his health was, how come? How come it's only the wife that was remaining? And nothing happened to her. God decided to spare her life, so that she will be able to stand in the gap to pray for the husband. How come nothing happened to her? She just appeared from nowhere. She was not sick. Nothing was wrong with her. Jesus is Lord. Nothing was wrong with her. And God did that because God gave her the opportunity to be of help, to understand the place of intercession. God, what is happening? What has my husband done? God, what is wrong? Our children, our properties, my husband's health. Do you know that a lot of women, they are only concerned about themselves? How to appear and make your move, your step, look attractive. Who is looking at you? Nobody. Hallelujah. And let me tell you something that struck my spirit. When the restoration came, her name was not mentioned anywhere again. She's gone into extinction. Her name was not mentioned again. If you are able to stand in the gap to intercede for your husband, you are able to stand in the gap to help your husband to keep running with the vision, like I said in the beginning, when the restoration comes, the revival shows up, you will be a beneficiary. I pray for you today as a pastor's wife here. For everyone that have gone in the wrong direction. For everyone that have given themselves to the devil to be used to pull down their husband's ministry. May the Lord show you mercy today. I say, may the Lord show you mercy today. If you believe that, let your amen be louder. Pray for him. See it as your duty. Pray for him. Pray for him. Don't start complaining. I don't know. Are you sure God called you? I don't know. Are you sure? And please tell me again. No, let me understand. You said you had an encounter in 1996. What actually happened? Was it an angel you saw? And how did it happen? I don't know. Maybe you need to explain to me again so that I get this thing clearly. Because I'm beginning to feel that you were not called. I don't understand. Look at the church. Last year we were 50, and this year we are 20. We are not even growing. Woman, stop complaining. Stop complaining and pick it up as a challenge. Stop complaining and pick it up as a contract to pray for your husband. Time will not permit me to go on and on and on. But I know with this little one, hallelujah. Let me quickly give you the third point under minister to your husband. Are you with me? The third one, I said the first one, believe in him. The second, I said pray for him. And the third, give him a good counsel. Give him a good counsel. A good counsel. The wife of Job, she said, curse God and die. Is that a good counsel? And do you know that in the Jewish law, until the man dies, the woman cannot remarry? So she was just waiting for the husband. Hey, this man, wait till you wait, die now. What are you waiting for? Kabatayakata. Die. And some of them, maybe they already have an alternative. Die, what are you waiting for? You are like an obstacle. If you don't go, another person will not come. He's not going anywhere. Ta 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 ta. about your own interest. Listen, if you are here, you are married to a pastor and your motive is different, don't allow the judgment of God come upon you. If you are married to a pastor and your motive is completely different, don't allow the wrath of God come upon you. Were you there when God called him? You were not there. When he had an encounter with the Lord. When I got married to my husband, we sat down and he started giving me his mandate. This is what God has revealed to me. To end affliction. Restore men to their destiny. By the revelation of the word. Manifestation of power. The reality of the Holy Ghost. I said, Jesus, help me not to be a hindrance to this man's mandate. Not to be a hindrance. Am I speaking to anybody here? Number three. I said, minister to your family. Minister to your family. A ministry without a good family is a mystery. The sons of Eli, you remember? The sons of Eli. The Bible says they were the sons of Belial. The sons of the devil. You can imagine that description. Woman! Understand your ministry to your family. Give your children that attention that they need. I hear some people say, "Pikin wey go spoil, he go spoil." That's not correct. That's not true. He says in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, train up the child in the way. There is a way. There is a way. The way of the Lord. Some women, pastor's wife, no longer bother about their children's spiritual welfare. They no longer bother. As God is using the man is ministering to the people, he's preaching. As you are ministering to God, ministering to your husband, you must also give attention to your children. Are you listening to me? I have discovered that some of the pastors who this day would complain, their children have become a reproach to the kingdom. A reproach. The Bible says that the sacrifice made for the Lord, the children of Eli, they were doing anyhow with it. My children, as soon as they get to the age of 5 to 6, I personally lead them to Jesus. You don't just assume that because they were born into the Christian home, oh, the father is a pastor, oh, the mother is a woman of God, and you just believe that automatically that they are born again. No. How many women today still introduce family altar? When it gets to 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, sometimes I'll take water in a can for some of them, maybe the ones staying with me that can really sleep. You know, some children, they like sleep. I'll just go there, knock the door. If I'm not getting any response, I'll start splashing the water on them. It's time. Get up, get up, get up, get up. Get up, get up. You see them stretching. Oh, mommy. Mommy, I said, stand up. It's time to pray. Stand up, stand up, stand up. If they are not used to it, they can't continue with it. Are you listening to me? You must understand your ministry to your family. Don't neglect it at all. And do you know that when the sons of Eli were mentioned. I started asking myself, where is the mother? Oh, can anybody here tell me the name of the mother? Was she mentioned? She was not mentioned. Meaning she lacked and she failed in her duty, her responsibility to the children. She was not mentioned. And I'm sure if the woman was in the picture, she would have been able to help to, you know, agree with her husband to rebuke these children. She would play her role as a mother to help these children not to go astray. Not to go astray. What are you doing as a pastor's wife? Give your children attention so that tomorrow you will not start regretting it. But you will not regret it in the name of Jesus. I didn't hear that amen very well. I said many pastors' wives do not care about, okay, I've told you that, the spiritual welfare of your child. It matters a lot. It matters a lot. Hallelujah. Check out their values. Check out their values. You need to put some measures on ground. Especially for those ones that are teenagers. Don't neglect them. Are you listening to me? Please don't neglect them. Put some measure of discipline on ground. A child comes back home, a pastor's child comes back home, maybe from a club. The mother will look at her, will pet her, I don't want to offend this child. You're not helping that child. There will be a problem. Put some measures on ground. Once it's 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, you don't come to this house late. You have to put your foot on the ground to help them to become better people. Hallelujah. Check out the friends, the kind of people they associate with. Check it out. They are dressing. Do you know? A lot of pastors' wives. You know that your daughter, what she's putting on to leave the house is not good enough. And you don't even bother. You don't even bother. Who are you waiting for? The father? No. It's your responsibility. You must put your foot on the ground. They must know. My children are just, they are still coming up. There are certain things I see them do. I'll call them and say, no. No, this one, it will not work. You can't do this. You can't appear like this. This one is wrong. This one, at this stage, I have to do it. Because if you don't do it, people will even, oh my God. I know God will help us in the name of Jesus. I said God will help us in the name of Jesus. I wrote down some things here. I said there's the price of motherhood. I think somebody needs to take note of this. The price of motherhood. The child's upbringing. I think I've emphasized on that. Her duties to her husband. We have emphasized on that. Her responsibility to her extended family. Home care and management. Then the role in nation building. And when these three things is in place, when these three things are in place, they are in order, now we can look at the pastor's wife ministering to the flocks. And this is going to be the last point. Ministering to the flocks. Your lifestyle, your character, your lifestyle. They are watching you. As a pastor's wife, as a matter of fact, the members, they even watch you more than they watch your husband. Your lifestyle, your character, your attitude. You must be a cheerful person. Are you listening to me? You don't know how to smile, you have to learn it. Because sometimes some people want to come to you as a mother, they want to seek for counsel, and when they look at your face, oh, they dodge it. They say, please, No, come and talk to me. No, 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 mommy. No, 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 no. Hallelujah. Because of the look on your face. So you must be cheerful. You must be receptive. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I said when they come, they see you. They look at you as a pastor's wife. They will have a better description of who you really are. They will have a better pastor's wife. If I ask you now, what is the description that the members of your church give to you? What will you say? What will you explain? A pastor's wife who is arrogant. A pastor's wife who is saucy. A pastor's wife who keeps smiles. A pastor's wife. What is the description? A pastor's wife who has unforgiving spirits. You are a mother. Not just a spiritual mother. I said, don't compete with members. I think I've said that when I started. Don't compete with members. I beg you. There's a place God is taking you and your husband to. Don't compete with them. Because you are a mother. Instill in them heaven's consciousness. You must always direct their attention to the Lord. You see anyone going astray, it's your duty to help them to come back to the Lord. Lift up your hands. Stand up. Let's be on a feet. Thank you, Jesus. Please, before I hand the microphone over to Daddy, there's a prayer point God is impressing in my spirit. Many of the pastor's wives, we have made mistakes. And these mistakes sometimes come as a result of the way you feel your husband is acting or behaving. Because I will not need to go into all that. But there shouldn't be any reason why you need to feel the way you are feeling now. Or causing the commotion, the division in the ministry. There shouldn't be any reason why you need to feel the way you are feeling to step out of the assignment God has given to your husband. There shouldn't be any reason why you need to feel that way, because you are a child of God. And a lot of women, they have made mistakes. You are going to cry out to God. And please, with all due respect to my husband, I would like all the pastors here to also pray, because God is angry with a lot of pastors' wives. God is angry with a lot of pastors' wives. And I don't want it to get to the point that God will start plucking them off. Because if you have made yourself an obstacle to the work that God has given to your husband, it's a problem. Many of us, we have made mistakes. Please, if you are already in the right path, you are helping to lead your husband in the right direction, thank God for that. But we are going to pray in one voice and say, Father, show mercy. Show mercy. You are a woman, a pastor's wife, you have made mistake. Begin to cry out to God and say, Father, show me mercy. Help me. I want to go back and retrace my steps. Begin to pray. You are a pastor, yeah, pray for your wife. Don't say you are tired. Don't say you are tired. Pray for her. Pray for her. There is something inside of her. There is something inside of her. But I know it's the devil that is fighting. It's the devil that is trying to stop her, to deprive her. You are not praying. Pray. Pray.
Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name. Good word, good word, good word. Hallelujah. I think we'll just, let's just close. We can just close on this word that we have heard.